Well, hello everyone, and welcome to another week with Live with Dr. McDougall, as we do every Thursday. And today we have a very special guest, Dr. Doug Lyle, and we're very lucky to have him the second Thursday of every month. Just a little bit about Dr. Lyle. He's a psychologist for the McDougall Wellness Program and the Director of Research for True North Health Center. And Dr. Lyle has lectured at Stanford, Cornell, and other universities, and is the co-author of The Pleasure Trap, Mastering the Hidden Force that Undermines Health and Happiness. And I really want to encourage all of you to visit his website, Esteem Dynamics, which is esteemdynamics.org. I will type it on the chat box so that you all have it in writing. And today he has a great presentation for us. So welcome, Dr. Lyle, and we're looking forward to what you have to say today.
Great. Thanks for having me. Today we're going to be talking about self-esteem and actually the stepping stones to building an inner self-regard that makes life better.
Very good. Looking forward to it. So go ahead and set up your PowerPoint presentation. I'm switching the screen to me. That way you have a few seconds to go ahead and do that. And I see that you're all set to go. So here we go.
Very good. This is Stepping Stones to Self-Esteem. And what we're going to do is we're going to take you on a little journey where we learn a little bit about the history of self-esteem, about the thinking on it, and then we're going to go on and try to see some new insights that may be helpful for folks. Now, this all started for me, the whole journey in psychology was, I was, of course, trying to be a great artist, which everybody knows clearly that I have talent. And here's my parents, and I went to them for more money for art supplies, thinking that I would, you know, get some good feedback there. And instead, what they figured was I needed a little more of a job rather than a little bit more money for art supplies, which, of course, this was rather disappointing. And so instead, I decided that instead of getting a real job, I'd go to psychology school. And there I learned from the great professor that I should have, of course, been more supported in my art, and that my father had damaged my self-esteem by giving me negative feedback about my art. So I was very happy about this, as you can see. And so then when I went home, I shared the news from the great professor that my dad had damaged my self-esteem. And actually, my dad thought that maybe my self-esteem had needed some damaging. So this kind of didn't go the way I would have figured. And of course, my mother agreed with him, which this was, you know, unacceptable. So what happened is the following. I learned early that my parents, and a lot of parents, do not share a theory that is widespread in psychology. And that theory is that little people, as they grow up, are kind of like bananas. And if you have any little thing happen to you that's a little bit uncomfortable, then it's like the banana gets bruised. If you're in the store and you have bananas that are nice and ripe and people pick them up, and they squeeze them a little bit, then you get all these little bruises on them. And essentially, there are theories of psychology that would essentially say that the right way to raise a kid is to make sure that nothing bad ever happens, because every time that something bad happens, their little self-esteem is bruised a little bit. Well, my folks kind of thought this was ridiculous. And as we go on today, we're going to see that the bruised banana theory, which actually has, I mean, doesn't go by that name, but it's a prominent idea in psychology, is actually without merit, and there is a different way of looking at the process of development and self-esteem that is much more accurate, and the more accurate we are, the more effective we can be at building internal self-regard. Now, one of the a major theorists who had a lot of good things to say but also had some misunderstandings was a man by the name of Nathaniel Brandon. And he was a prominent figure in self-esteem psychology in the 1960s and 70s and 80s. And essentially, he felt like more self-esteem was better, and that self-esteem is sort of like a vitamin. And if your self-esteem was low, then bad things would happen to you. And if your self-esteem was higher, good things would happen to you. And so this was kind of an important concept. And actually, a lot of government money and attention went into trying to help raise the self-esteem of children, because it was the notion was high self-esteem led to good outcomes and low self-esteem led to bad outcomes. And we're going to see some very important mistakes there in that thinking. This is a terror management theory coming out of anthropology, notion that people did things to try to enhance their self-esteem is that they knew they were going to die. And so out of terror of death, they would do things like build Washington monuments and to try to survive into the hereafter somehow. This is sort of a curious way of thinking, and I don't fully understand why they think this, but they do. And anyway, there's no research to support it. Now, my pet theory about all this as I went on to psychology was that these ideas are a little bit nuts. And what we're going to do is we're going to look at a theory of self-esteem that is on much firmer footing so we can understand how it works. These banana theories and terror management theories are what I call wandered into the weeds. You know, they were very interesting and bold attempts to try to understand the internal process of people, but they fell far short. And now we're going to try to get on a pathway where we can really understand self-esteem and not be out into the bananas and the weeds. Now, we're going to quickly look at the history of self-esteem, and I'm sure that some philosophers from Greece had brilliant things to say about this. Here's one philosopher here. He's in a toga. Now, actually, I had a friend of mine look at this, and she told me that Greeks didn't wear togas, but it was too late. That was the Romans, apparently. But the slide had already been made, so there's nothing I can do about this. Now, if we hopscotch forward to 1890, William James, who is really the first American psychologist, he had a few ideas about self-esteem. He didn't really say that much about it, but this was just sort of his first take, thoughtful take, about how to look at this process. First of all, it was a feeling that people have about themselves, and he also noticed that it changed and that it's also related to competence. And so these are three ideas, early ideas, coming out of really the most influential American psychologist in the 19th century. We're going to revisit William James a little bit later as we sort of put together and explore some of these ideas that he first had. Now this, some of you, of course, know who this is, but some of you don't. This is Edward O. Wilson. You should know by the distinctive ants that are crawling all around him. He's the world's leading authority on ants at Harvard University. And Edward O. Wilson actually came up with a concept called consilience, which puts self-esteem in an interesting perspective, even though he didn't intend to do it. And this is the notion of consilience, and this is how we're going to frame self-esteem in the context of essentially the life sciences. Consilience is the idea that there's a unity of knowledge in the universe. It goes from how physics works, and then physics will determine chemistry, and chemistry will determine the laws of biochemistry. Laws of biochemistry will determine the laws of biology. Biology will determine the laws of psychology, and psychology will determine how things happen in sociology, anthropology, economics, political science, the arts, everything. In other words, so what we see is that there can't be something that's going on in biology that is inconsistent with the laws of chemistry, and we can't see things that are going on in political science that are inconsistent with the laws of psychology. In other words, knowledge is integrated, and therefore, if psychologists are going to try to understand psychology better, what they need to do is go a step backwards and to understand biology. If they understand biology, then it will help them understand psychology. In the same way that if a chemist is struggling to understand something in chemistry about some phenomenon they don't understand, the place to go looking is physics. Go one level down and try to make sure you understand the fundamentals there. So it turns out that other theories had not considered this, so they were lost in space. And if you guys remember the old show Lost in Space, this was dangerous. Robbie the robot telling us, look, if you don't know what you're doing, you're in a lot of trouble. So we're going to go back to biology, and biology is going to rescue us. and help us put our investigation of self-esteem on a very firm footing. So once again, we're going to begin with William James, and it's starting with self-esteem as a feeling. So first, let's understand what feelings are, because we know that self-esteem, an important component of it, is simply how it is that we feel about ourselves. So we first need to understand what a feeling is. Now, what we see, first of all, is that sensations or feelings of that kind are very clearly signals. So if you're hungry, it's telling you to do something, which is to eat. If you're cold, it's telling you to get warmer. If your foot's sore, it's telling you to not walk on it. And if you're tired, it's telling you to sleep. So your feelings are actually not random. They're actually biological signals that are orienting the organism to tell it what to do in its best biological interest. So here's a gal hiking in the woods. So let's make her some ancient person. And she looks out on a landscape, and what we're going to see is she sees the river and the trees, and she feels like it's beautiful. She has a positive feeling towards it. That's because that landscape is showing cues that are good for human beings to survive, like water and trees and fruit and so on and so forth. If she's looking out on a desert, she might not feel like it was so beautiful, a big pile of rocks, or maybe a strip mine, or maybe a garbage heap. Okay, none of those would have that same feeling. This feeling is a cue to signal the organism that she's actually in good circumstances for human beings. And here's a boy looking at a girl, and he's thinking the same thing, beautiful. And why that is that is also a feeling telling him that's a place to try to figure out how to reproduce his DNA. So these are our basic life processes, and when you have a beautiful landscape or a beautiful person or beautiful music, beautiful sounds, these beautiful scenery, these are actually signs that things are valuable in some fashion. Sometimes it's a little tricky to figure out what they are, but that is why we have those positive feelings. We also have negative feelings. So here's my cat taking a dump on the carpet, and of course I'm not happy about it. So, and the reason why is that's bacterial contamination that I'm going to have to deal with. And the cat seems happy about it. I'm not. And this is again, feelings orienting us towards the biological processes here, either positive or negative. So we're going to go back now and say, well, now, wait a minute. Isn't self-esteem a feeling? If it's a feeling, then this is a signal. And we need to try to figure out what it's trying to signal us if we're going to make use of that signal. So it is in fact a signal process. So let's try to get a little bit of a feeling as to what self-esteem is signaling. Now, the first scientist that actually figured this out was a guy by the name of Dr. Mark Leary, now at Duke University. And he was the first one to say, yes, self-esteem is in fact a signal. And we're going to use the lens of biology to try to understand what it's signaling. And what he comes up with is the notion that self-esteem, the feeling of self-esteem, is a social acceptance feedback meter. So it's just like a meter on your car. So high self-esteem just means that you're getting lots of acceptance, and low self-esteem means you're getting a lot of rejection. Now, I want to point out that this is fundamentally different than the notion that, for example, Nathaniel Brandon would have said. Nathaniel Brandon would have said that high self-esteem is just a good thing that you want a lot of, and that bad things happen if you have low self-esteem, that it's like a vitamin. Leary is saying, no, it's not anything like this. It's not a need that is being filled that you need. In fact, it's a result of something that's happening, not a cause. So high self-esteem is a result of getting feedback that says you're being accepted, and low self-esteem is a evidence that you're being rejected. And in that way, this would be a very important thing for people to have, because if you are doing things that cause you to be accepted, you want to essentially be encouraged to continue to do those things that are socially successful. And if you do things that are causing rejection, then you want to not be doing those things. So in this way, Leary is saying that this is very much like being too hot, too cold. being hungry or not. This is a mechanism for telling you what to do. Now, the what we're going to do is we're going to look and see, here's a guy named Fred, and he's got essentially three classes of relationships that he's trying to get acceptance from possible mates, from possible friends, and possible employers or customers. And so he's going to want a feedback system to tell him when things are going well, and that feedback system is going to be an esteem sensitivity. In other words, how people value him is going to cause him to feel things. So Leary would say self-esteem is feedback for social behavior, and he actually calls it a sociometer. He says you've got a sociometer in your head that is telling you when you've been accepted and when you've been rejected, and the feeling of high self-esteem is when the sociometer is telling you you've been accepted, and when you've been rejected, the sociometer tells you that as well. So he went to the laboratory with this idea, and what he did was he had people interact in a group, and then he each gave them individual feedback after the group as to what the rest of the group thought of them by saying that the group got along, and so they're going to hang out again next week and do something, and that you, though, have either been invited or you haven't been invited. And so this is what he did, and it turned out this is what happened to people's self-esteem. When they interacted with the group, everybody is at the beginning, at the start, and then they either get feedback that says they were accepted by the other people or that they were being rejected by the other people. And it turned out that then you measure people's self-esteem, and when they got accepting feedback, their self-esteem rose, and when they got rejecting feedback, their self-esteem lowered. So this is critical now to the notion that if self-esteem is something that is built brick by brick from the time you're a little kid, then it shouldn't be this dynamic. It shouldn't be changing in a matter of half an hour with respect to feedback. And so this is now challenging the notion that it's a vitamin or that it's a very subtle process that goes on bruise by bruise and rejection by rejection. That is, in fact, not what Leary is showing here. He's showing that 20, 30 minutes of hanging out with some people and doing group project, and then you find out you're either accepted or not, has a major impact on how you feel about yourself right then. This is now much more like a hunger drive. In other words, this is an orienting feedback telling you about success or failure. And that is apparently the truth. Now, Leary was criticized for this when he showed this result. And people said, well, that's because you're dealing with college students and they have very frail self-esteems and they're not very grown-up real people. And so real strong people don't care what anybody thinks. And they wouldn't be so subject to the feedback. And so Dr. Leary, of course, says, well, if that's true, there's probably something badly wrong with you. If you're not sensitive to what other people are, the feedback that you're giving, then this is a disaster. And so what he did is he actually ran a study where he took those people that, quote, didn't care what the feedback was from other people. And when they ran those people in the study, they came up with exactly the same results you just saw. In other words, it didn't make any difference at all. If people that, quote, said they don't care what other people think were giving rejecting feedback, their self-esteem lowered, and if they were given positive feedback, it raised. So this is a universal feature of human nature. Now we're going to go on to a little gal named Joni here, and we're going to look at her self-esteem. And Joni's got three classes of people that she's interested in getting feedback from: potential mates, potential friends, and potential employers or customers, i.e. involved in work and trade. And so her self-esteem mechanism, or what Leary would call her sociometer, is going to be sensitive to feedback from each of those domains. Now, the thing is each of these domains is a competitive process. So if she gets positive feedback from one of these guys that she's interested in, her self-esteem should rise. And it actually makes you feel happy to have your self-esteem rise. If she gets rejecting feedback, it should fall. And it should be a signaling device to tell her that whatever it is that she was trying to sell, basically, wasn't effective. The same thing would be true in trade or with friendships. So if she was seeking a job or a customer and she got positive feedback, it should make her feel good about herself. And if she gets rejected, it should make her feel a little bit worse. And so this is the nature of self-esteem. It's actually a dynamic process. Now, so for potential mates, here's two people meeting, and what they're doing is that they're actually running a cost benefit on each other because they're running a competitive analysis of this individual against other individuals they could maybe hook up with. And so therefore, the feedback systems are sensitive to whether this is a good deal. And if you think it's a good deal and they don't think it's a good deal and you get rejected, then your self-esteem takes a little ding for that period of time. That's actually what it's designed to do, is it's designed to be sensitive to feedback. So if two people, somebody wants to be friends, people are looking for feedback from the other person. And let's imagine now why this would be useful. Let's suppose that you were trying to make friends in a new village and nobody wanted to be your friend. Then you should have a system that tells you that you're in trouble to try to get you to actually figure out how to act differently in a way that's going to cause acceptance. As soon as you would do that and get acceptance in some way, you should then feel better about yourself. So in this way, these feelings are guidance systems to help engineer social success, which is critical for survival and reproductive success in our species. So what people are doing really is they're advertising for these human relationships. And so people advertise in different ways. And so this is a kind of a turtle. And what it does is it sticks its neck out, wiggles it around. And if the male does this in a way that the female finds pleasing, then she gives him good feedback. I've tried this in humans and this does not work. Now, other birds will get to the top of trees and they'll chirp and chirp and chirp. And the reason why there's bird song is they're all just basically saying the same thing. They're singing a song that says, mate with me. I haven't found this to be effective either. Now, it's also true that they'll try to just there's a lot of times advertise their sheer strength. So this is in the chimpanzee arena. Male chimps will grab bushes and they'll shake them to show how strong they are. And the females will try to see who's the strongest and look at these displays. I've tried this and it does not work either. So I'm just cueing in the young men in the audience. I'm telling you that these things don't work in humans. Now, these are the classic display advertisements of our species for mates: singing, dancing, athletics, and beauty. These are universal characteristics that human beings use to try to advertise. And pop culture that you see out there, singing, dancing, athletics, beauty contests, these are in fact the ways that human beings display and advertise. And their self-esteems go up and down depending upon whether they get good feedback or bad feedback. I'm not really poking fun at this at all. This is what I call serious fun. People like to make displays and they like to look at these displays because we're people. So we are actually connoisseurs of these display processes. Now, Joni's displays is that she tries to display for mates here, for to show her style and her dancing and her singing and her smarts and her beauty. In other words, that's what she's trying to show. And for friends, she's trying to show some things as well, and for trade as well. So in trade, you can see it's a little bit more about how hardworking and reliable and honest you are, and that's not quite what you display in mating. So they don't have contests, mating contests, that are all about that. Notice that the mating contests tend to be about beauty and dancing and singing, and that's because each domain has its own advertisement process. So if we look at Joni, we see that she has an esteem meter in her head. That's what I call it. Dr. Leary would call it a sociometer, but I call it an esteem meter for a reason that we'll get to shortly. So here she's responsive to either good or bad feedback from the mates or the friends or the trading partners. And when she gets good feedback, she feels accepted and her self-esteem rises. And when she gets bad feedback, her self-esteem falls and she creates anxiety and embarrassment and doubt. This is essential, folks. Bad feedback is causing the self-esteem to be lower is actually just as essential as it is to have a hunger drive or to feel too cold or to have the pain in your ankle. The notion that bad self-esteem causes bad outcomes is a terrible misunderstanding of psychology that actually is the bedrock theory that even exists today. So if you listen to Dr. Phil, or you listen to or had heard of Nathaniel Brandon and the entire self-esteem movement, literally they're not understanding the causal direction here. The esteem meter is designed by nature as a guidance system, and it is essential to have lowered self-esteem when you are getting negative feedback. That's the only way that you can figure out how to correct it. And in the same way that if you eat something that causes you to throw up, this is essential that you feel a little bit of nausea around that food in the future for a while. These are guidance systems, and we need to respect them as such. Now, so it's going to turn out that our competitive displays will improve with rehearsals. And so, of course, just think back on your first date. And I don't like to think back on my first date. But when I do, I realize that things did get better, actually. I mean, it was a long, painful, slow process. However, I did become more confident at that process than I was when I was 16, and all of us have. So sometimes we have to have failure feedback and lowered self-esteem to encourage us to do things differently and to practice. So here's Joni getting ready for a date, and what she does, she actually looks in the mirror and gets ready and checks herself to try to help herself deal with this competitive process. So it's very interesting that she is preparing in advance for an advertisement, and that she's using her own eyes as a way of analyzing whether she is ready. And so we're going to get to this in a second now. This is my neighbor out in front of his yard, and this guy is looking at his house as if other people are looking at it. And what we see is that if he feels like it looks good, then he actually feels better about himself. So essentially his imagination goes through the process of saying, okay, I think it now looks good. My display is now ready. If other people were to be right here and looking at my house, they would say, wow, John, that is a really nice house, and they would give him good feedback. So it's interesting that he feels good about himself from feedback from other people, even those other people are not actually there. And this is a fascinating characteristic of human beings, that they have a way of transmitting this process to themselves. I actually make sure that my yard looks so that my neighbor can think that his yard looks better than mine to help his self-esteem. That's why we do that. Now, so don't be overwhelmed by this chart here. This is all going to make sense. So here we see the mates, friends, and trading partners, and we see Joni's esteem meter. And we see that if we go to the right there, to be competitive, she has to rehearse her displays. Like she's going to rehearse her dancing, or she's going to rehearse by putting the clothes on and her makeup for the date. But she needs a feedback system to help her while she's rehearsing in order to make sure that her rehearsals are improving her. And in order to do that, she needs an audience to give her feedback. And the audience she uses is actually an internal audience. The human beings have invented in their natural history a set of neural tissue that effectively creates an internal audience of people watching us. Now, it's not always watching us, but it very often is. So when you're cleaning up your house or cleaning up your yard or putting on a new shirt and looking in the mirror, you're actually using your internal audience to give you feedback to your esteem meter. And if you think it has improved your competitive process and your advertisement looks sharper, then your self-esteem rises. And if you feel like it's made you look worse, or your house looks worse, or the couch doesn't look good over there, move it back. That's because your esteem meter is telling you that you believe that if other people were to see the display now, it looks worse. So we now have an internal process that is independent of actual real people that's going on inside of people's heads. And so this internal audience and the feedback that it gives to the esteem meter is what I call self-esteem. The other esteem is what I call esteem. So if Joni gets real live feedback from a guy named Horace and she's all excited, that's esteem from Horace. But self-esteem is what happens when the internal audience has Joni look in the mirror and she says, wow, that looks good on me. That is a self-esteem signal that is telling her that it believes that she has improved her competitive position in this process of getting ready to meet Horace. So this is how, so it really turns out there are two different esteem processes. The self-esteem process is actually designed to help us get ready for the other processes. And now this was anticipated many years ago by a grand old man of Harvard University, a clinical psychologist by the name of Robert White. And he basically just said this. He said what he calls self-esteem had two sources, the outside and the inside. When other people gave good feedback, or it was good feedback from the outside, and then also when he had feedback from the inside. Now, his view wasn't very sophisticated, but you know what? It was right on target. It was just an early psychologist looking at this problem and saying, you know what? There's two sources of this feeling. And so I have divided it up into actually esteem versus self-esteem to help delineate this conceptually. But this is what he was thinking, and of course, he was right on target. So it's going to turn out that, just as a quick slide here, that her self-esteem mechanism is actually, you see what people display to the far right, which is beauty, intelligence, personality, factors, all kinds of things that people are displaying. She could be getting negative feedback in the mating arena from the man Horace that she's interested in, but getting pretty good feedback from friends and so-so feedback from work, or she could be getting great feedback from work, not good feedback from Horace, or she could be getting great feedback from Horace and lousy feedback from her best friend. In other words, the concept that self-esteem is unitary is mistaken, that your self-esteem has highs and lows depending upon the feedback that you're getting from the domain that's involved. And so this is now much more sophisticated than a notion that your self-esteem is just this unitary thing that that you carry with you all the time, either slowly building or slowly decreasing. Here's Joni now looking at a goal. She thought if she would lose 40 pounds, she'd be more accepted. Now she's got some friend named Slim Sue. So I want you to think about this dynamic. So Slim Sue's looking at Joni and thinking, you know, I really like you, Joni, you're a fine person, but, you know, you've got a weight problem, obviously. So Slim Sue may not say this, but she's thinking this. Now Joni may be knowing that Slim Sue thinks this, so she's going to try to say, look, Slim Sue, I am going to lose some weight. And so if she does, think that Slim Sue, let's think about what Slim Sue is going to be thinking. She's going to be thinking that, you know what, I don't believe that. I've heard that 27 times before. So Slim Sue may not say I don't believe it, but she probably doesn't believe it. That being the case, the same thing is going to be happening inside Joni, that her internal audience is going to not be believing her when she says, I'm going to lose some weight. Now, the internal audience's whole point is to try to anticipate what real life people would think. So if Joni was thinking, okay, well, if I lost some weight, I'd get better feedback. So maybe I'm going to tell people that I'm going to lose some weight. Well, if you lose a pound, you're going to get no positive feedback from the world because they can't tell. And the internal audience is not going to be very impressed if you tell yourself, hey, I think I'm going to do this. They're not going to be any more believing than Slim Sue would believe. But I want you to imagine that, let's suppose that Joni actually works very, very hard for 3 or 4 weeks. Let's call it 3 weeks. Now, first 2 or 3 days, Slim Sue's got her arms crossed and isn't believing anything. That would also mean that Joni herself, her internal audience, should also have the same reaction. Like, I don't believe it. But if you continue on and continue to work, if Slim Sue were able to observe every move Joni made, which is exactly what her internal audience does, then even within a couple of weeks, Slim Sue would say, wow, you're really impressing me. And Joni would say, well, I'm down 4 pounds. Now Slim would say, well, I can't see it, but it is apparently true because I can see everything that you've done in the last 2 weeks, and I can, you know, and I've watched you step on the scale and it looks like that's actually happening. The internal audience will have the same reaction. The internal audience, if you grit it out and actually do a very good job, the internal audience is watching you, and your self-esteem will rise long ahead of any positive feedback that comes from the outside world. So this is the way to attack a problem like weight loss or actually any other goal that is difficult, that is important for our esteem and our self-esteem, is to gut it out knowing that the self-esteem mechanism will give you positive feedback way ahead of any positive feedback that other people are there for. This is an essential understanding of self-esteem. Understand just how different this is than the concept that we have today, that if a child's self-esteem is low, we're going to heap a bunch of praise on him in order to have him feel better about himself. This is pseudo-esteem. This is just dinging the little meter, basically giving it junk food. Instead, what needs to happen is he needs to understand where he is actually struggling in the competitive process. He needs to then be encouraged and shown the fundamentals to work at the problem so that he gets actually more effective. And then when he does that and puts in the work, his self-esteem will rise, whether or not he's getting better feedback from other people yet or not. This is actually the stepping stones to put firm foundations behind the self-esteem process. The problem is that when we begin, self-esteem doesn't rise quickly and other people give us no encouragement. So this could be motivational checkmate if we don't understand this process. So this is Slim Sue now. This is our gal. If she diligently works at this process for even 14 days, Slim Sue, if Slim Sue were watching, would be impressed and starting to say, maybe you are really onto something here, which is exactly what the self-esteem mechanism will do if you are diligent. So this is how we want to attack this problem, is knowing that the self-esteem rise that we may seek is out there, and it's out there closer than we think. It's actually designed to be much closer to us than the esteem that we would get from other people. So for example, if you are if you're working at a class in math and you're struggling with it and you're sort of quitting and giving up, and then you decide, I'm going to work really hard, I'm going to get some help, and I'm going to grind this thing through. As you do this, if you've gotten some bad feedback, you do not have good esteem from your teacher. The teacher does not think that you're much of a student. However, if you are quietly grinding in your house and you are getting better and seeing that you're getting better, you are, in fact, your self-esteem is rising even though you have not gotten any positive feedback yet. When you go and take a test and you do a good job, then you get the esteem from the outside. But the self-esteem was happening far before the esteem would happen. My mother grew up in a little town, in a little gold mining ghost town called Placerville, Idaho. And about 40 people lived there her whole life. It was 10 miles off a dirt road, way north of Boise, Idaho. And it turned out that her great-grandfather named Perry Fairchild owned a little mining claim called Gold Hill. And he mined that for many, many years and just struggled to make a little living out of it. It was not very effective. And one day, finally, he decided to sell his claim called Gold Hill. And a new mining operation came in, and they sunk a shaft, 20 feet deep or something, and took out $6 million worth of gold. Quickly, which of course my mother tells that story. That's our family's tale of woe. Actually, it's a good thing for me, because then she wouldn't have been a struggling young teacher and met my father, and then I wouldn't have happened. So it's actually a good thing as far as I'm concerned that Perry Fairchild didn't know that he had a rich claim. Now, but my point when she told me this story was, I said, that's just like self-esteem. Self-esteem is much closer to the surface than people know. Self-esteem is not destroyed by the 1,001 rejections that we get in this life from the time we're little kids, and that we're a bruised banana by the time we're 50 that can't be repaired. That is not true. Self-esteem is right under the surface. As quickly as you start digging and showing the diligence and then start to get some positive feedback from improving your display, whatever it is that you're trying to work on, whether it's your house, your garden, your waistline, your math abilities, your ability to dance, doesn't make any difference. Whatever it is, your self-esteem is very close to the surface, It's just like that gold. And if we start digging, we do not have to wait for other people to tell us. We do not have to wait for their encouragement. In fact, their encouragement and accolades will come after they start to see that we have improved. And that will be very nice. Esteem is a wonderful thing to get from other people when it's authentic and when it's realistic and fair. It is useless when it comes when it's phony or just telling somebody that they have done really well when they have not. Self-esteem, the feeling that comes from knowing that I have done a good job and I have earned it, that is something that only you can give to you and only you can actually earn it. And the thing is you're designed to earn it, and your nervous system will in fact give it to you. Your internal audience will give it to you if you go about the process of diligent effort in the face of some difficulty. And that, folks, is the reasonable price of self-esteem. And if you pay that price, it is not that high. Your nervous system is designed by nature to encourage you when you start moving in the right direction and put out good efforts. It respects you for those efforts, even though you may struggle a bit, it's okay. In the same way that you would respect anybody that struggles, but they're struggling and working hard, your own internal audience does the same thing for you. And your self-esteem must rise as a result of this. And this is the key to having the life you deserve. And that's what we have today.
And
here we go.
Dr. Lyle, that was a truly marvelous presentation, captivating. Wow, you have given us so much to think about. The last few minutes, it really made me, reminded me of my journey from going to being an overweight person to losing about 80 pounds and how the self-esteem changed. And so that it's not something that it's, like you said, it's not set.
Yes.
Dr. Lyle, would you mind clicking this your screen so that you stop sharing the PowerPoint presentation? And then, there you go. Okay. Yeah. Okay. I can see you. And personally, thank you. And I know everybody here has had a great experience. And I want to mention one more time, and I'm putting here on the screen now, that to be able to reach you, they can email you at drdouglyle@yahoo.com, and they can visit your website for, I think you do private one-on-one consultations, right?
I sure do. Those are, people can either write to me and ask me about that, or they can also just go to my website, and my website has a appointment program, and they can schedule appointments anytime they want.
Very good. Very good. We will, I don't know if you have anything else that you want to add.
Well, I would just say that I've said it all because it's such a, I'm very passionate about this.
Yes.
When people feel down and defeated, sometimes they sort of feel like they're kind of stopped, you know, forever, or that this sort of that they're doomed to have these kind of low internal feelings. And the misunderstanding of self-esteem throughout the history of psychology has essentially aided and abetted this through our lack of understanding of the process. But really the truth is that we have tremendous amount of control over our self-esteem. We don't have so much control over the esteem signals that we get from other people, whether they ever think much of our efforts, but we have almost complete indirect control over our own self-esteem process. And so you will have the self-esteem, it will be given to you if you earn it. And your internal audience, you might be your own toughest critic, but you will still impress that critic, not necessarily with brilliant outcomes, but with excellent effort, the critic is always impressed. And that's what we wanna know. We wanna know we can feel much better. I have people that can feel much better literally in 3 days going on a new diet and exercise program. They can feel much better about themselves, even though they may be 3 months away from any positive feedback from the outside world.
Right, right. That's a key ingredient. That's very important.
Yes.
Wow. Well, thank you again. And
thank you for having me. Doctor, it's just a pleasure to talk to you all folks, and I look forward to next time.
Very good. We'll see you in about a month or so.
Terrific. Fantastic. Okay.
Bye-bye, everybody.